So, I am Mark, but I get to be the facilitator for this breakout session all around Predation. So I will sort of manage our conversation. Our goal is to see what we support, what changes are needed for things to support, what should be really prioritized in that 2018 plan versus where are things still needing a lot of discussion and work that be addressed by the group and then included next year. We have about six actions and they all have interconnections between them, so we'll have that discussion. Penny is the co-chair of the PREY working group, so she's been managing the team of experts. Her job here is to present the points of view and the expertise that came from that discussion. So both supporting and dissenting from a different point of view. So when she speaks, she's speaking from here's what the working group is thinking about, not here's what I particularly believe or don't believe. It's not her job. Her job is to help us think about the whole perspective as task force members who are less experts and what the experts say. We also have a couple of people who are, in addition, experts here. Guy Norman from the Northwest Power Conservation Council, whatever you call it now. And he's a governor appointee to that council, an expert in fish and dams and the whole set of issues there. And then Michael Schmidt, along with the Kings, has done a lot of research. He's an expert in the issues of predation and fish related to Puget Sound and the outer coast. So we've got those resources to draw on, and we have drawn on them in our other discussions, and they've been very helpful. So, any questions or, you guys are hanging in there. Yeah, Terry?
Well, it's not directly related to PREY, but what I was saying earlier in the opening introduction was that nutrient loading is much more severe in Puget Sound than PREY. The last studies have been showing that it lost already over 80% of the plankton in Puget Sound. And the plankton is the plot of the food chain. And as that continues to increase in cost, we're losing Chinook. And this thing will take Chinook and it's like, well, can I have the food for the whale? We'll run a Chinook. We have to get back to this option anyway. So I'd recommend that we add the ecosystem to create the cycle and the risk that we definitely need to stop the input of plants and agricultural farming, development of soils, things like that for a few others that are releasing all those nutrients in the sound.
Great. We have other recommendations around habitat that may address part of that, but I think you're also bringing up another element of the complicated human impact on its environment picture that we'll go back to the work of the process. But yeah, there's other recommendations that received a lot of support in the survey, and we're not talking about them. We're talking about the ones here that are within that predation thing that are specific to all understanding that context. So to give you a quick overview of these recommendations that we're going to be talking about and then to dive into them, we have the first one, B4, is really a science. It's about science and research and about getting the, as put it last week, filling the gaps in knowledge to be able to do any kind of action, decide on any kind of action around predation. And that's particularly important as a gateway for a certain actions that you might do under the Marine Mammal Protection Act. So basically, we don't know a lot. We know some more on the Columbia River side than we do on the Puget Sound side. We need to know more as we move forward with this. So the recommendation here is as a starter, let's refine and get better science and do that I'm just going to give a quick overview and then we'll come back. The next two, Hydro C and Predator B2, Predation B2, are about what's happening in the Columbia River water hotspots and dealing with birds and a little bit with pinnipeds about management options for addressing those hotspots. The working group that basically thought that there is a lot of, that everything that's under D2 is really included as a specific set of actions under micro C, so we'll talk about those together. The next two, predation A1 and predation B1, are about how to deal with pinnipeds in specific locations and where are those specific locations. And one is, the first one is about addressing artificial call-outs and removing or dealing with those artificial structures and habitats that have attracted some of the predators. The other one is about mutual removal. And then the final action is one that's actually not well supported by the task force in the survey, but was brought back because some task force members suggested it, and this is about, instead of having a specific targeted action, you would set yourself a baseline population, and then use lethal removal to get the mass, obviously much more broader, aggressive, and impactful in terms of relationships to the Environmental Protection Act. So Kathy's going to be helping taking notes. We'll capture those in color here. And then all this gets fed into where are we? We have consensus and direction. Where are we for the, what fits in 2018 versus 2019? So once you, we'll start back at the beginning with the science one, but did you have a question about that?
Well, maybe before we go to that, let's walk through the specific actions. So in each blue box, you'll see the working group has provided like sub-letters. And those sub-letters have options from the working group that give more specificity what that action could look like. In this case, there's one that applies to Columbia River, and the other applies to Puget Sound. And A, under the Columbia River, is a need for specific estimates of Chinook survival between the mouth of the Columbia and Bonneville. And in B, it's more of a, I guess, broad information needed on consumption of pinnipeds, new information that is geographically specific to each area about pinniped numbers, and bringing that science up to speed so that you could use it to get management authority to appropriate. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Thoughts
on this, and again, Guy can talk more about this. Joe,
yeah. What, you want to say something first?
Well, like somebody mentioned about the main group, you can science this thing to death. And on the Columbia River, been 25 years of science on pinnipeds, and at least that much on birds. I specifically know about the biggest bird eating island is 2.2 miles from my house, and fish by it pretty much every day or drive by. So I don't understand the statement is that we need a lot more science. We've got bills in Congress, one went through the Senate, our House, now that's one through the Senate, and I think that an important kicker to get it over the hump in the Senate might be the support of this group to save the killer whales or defensive. So I think the time is now to either, you know, go to the bathroom or get off the pot. And I know the thinking is in the Senate bill.
3119.
There you go.
Yeah, and this ties into our B2, B1 coming up. Yeah.
I understand, but I'm so awful, so I just decided I never ever come back. So,
not the only one.
So, was it? Anyway, of course, that's a thought. But anyway, I, you know, if we so choose and passes, and we maybe get to dispatch a animal or two in the Columbia River, the sun will come up and the river will still run it out, and hopefully that'll help Puget Sound, springboard Puget Sound to be soon to follow. And so trying to bite all at one time is a pretty big lift by Congress. not that they need to be done, it should be something quickly, but I think that the support of this group to help that move along in Congress is of the utmost importance.
So you're sort of saying we don't need to spend a lot more time on science, we need to spend.
Maybe in days before around to South Science, but science pretty did it done in the Columbia River.
So we had a similar question in a previous group. Guy, you want to chime in on this?
Sure.
A, why I was suggesting.
So, relative to the Columbia River, there has, and Butch is right, we've had a lot of data associated with PIMP information and showing that rapid increase in impacts of sea lions on salmon in the Columbia River. That information that has been put together, number one, was the justification for the current management authority, which is limited to Bonneville Dam. It also, the more recent information that shows growing impact up to 43% in 1 year, but an average of 20 to 30% of the adult spring Chinook salmon is really what the key piece of science was that attained congressional support, Northwest delegation support for the legislation that's currently in front of the Senate that has already passed the House. So information's been key for existing limited authority. Information was key for the legislation that would expand that management authority and include the tribe as well as the states. Also in that legislation, there is a 5-year review, if it does pass and become law, that to go back and take a look at what's happening with the impact. Is it decreasing? Is it continuing to increase? Is the management action actually effective? So there's a key ongoing need for that research to rationalize and then justify the management.
Could you be a little more specific about that 43%? 43% of returns increase, what
does that mean? So that was the high issue, that was 2014, and NOAA fisheries.
But just connect the dots. So many, many heads were removed and runs increased by 43%, what is it?
So of the spring Chinook salmon destined for above Bonneville Dam, so Snake River spring Chinook, Upper Columbia spring Chinook, 43% of those adults were impacted by sea lions or killed by sea lions, according to that study. Highest year, the numbers range from 15 to 43%, depending on the year.
And so just for clarity around Butch's initial comment, and I think another question that was asked elsewhere is, if we already have the science and it's already something that's ongoing, why does this need to be in here, was kind of one of the questions. And what this really would call for is an expansion of additional research that's already out there. And so to get what you would need for a specific estimate of survival between the mouth of the Columbia and Bonneville Dam isn't something that we currently have. So there would need some funding in order to make that happen.
So just clarification. So that has been funded since 2010 through 18. I don't believe that it's marked for funding after 2018. So there is a funding, future funding.
All right, so we have Joe, and then you, and then Jerry, and me. You, and Jerry.
Yes, so it seems about 10 years ago, I was on a animal care use committee, I think for Section 7, to take out sea lions out at the Bonneville Dam. If I remember correctly, animals had to be tagged, had to be 3-time offenders, and then were euthanized. And I think that we provided the numbers of those animals that were killed at Bonneville. But I haven't seen any data on the effectiveness of that, the numbers of animals killed, what's happened to the population, and what's happened with the runs, and then the relationship with that. So it seems to me like we've been taking some action down there in the Columbia River at Bonneville, but I haven't really seen any results on whether that is doing anything, whether we just kill a sea lion and another one just comes in, so just keep killing more and more sea lions. So that's the type of thing, and I look at this, some of the other ones that are farther down, I think that it was in our B2 or it was A1, and the effectiveness, wherever I see effectiveness as judged by the external science panel, I'm seeing low to medium, and when I see medium, I see a high degree of debate between the scientists on the effectiveness. And so I know that they're there, which I hear you. You see them every day eating those salmon, and you see them eating those other things. But so that's, you know, observation is there. But what that's really, what is the culling actually doing to the benefit? That's what I don't know. I haven't seen it.
He said push the batteries all over.
Yeah, so I'd say this thing is about that. What's the, what do we know?
Right, right.
More about, yeah.
The biggest mistake that we made in doing this, and in fact, you could have dispatched less sea lions, but the optic is horrible. Any sea lion hunter from the day would tell you behavior is learned by sea lions and is learned fast. So by capturing it, taking it 25 miles away, giving it its last supper, bringing a priest in, giving it its last rites was a great way to do that. Except none of his brothers and sisters and cousins and whatever saw that happen. So there was no consequence to the action. If I know it's a terrible optic, but if those sea lions were dispatched right in front there, you would have had probably half as many killed that would have started moving those sea lions away from the dam because of behavior.
Grant.
Great. Let's get these comments out, and then I sort of call the question about we're kind of on the science and research one, and then we want to move to the other ones that are more specific. So
Guy, is it your sense that the research is needed in order to satisfy the legislation? Or to support the legislation that is described here?
Yes.
Because that which is described today is really different than what you're describing, Joe. You're asking a different question than what's described
here. And I think they're related. I think there's, with the research, ongoing research, plus what the Corps is doing at the Mondo Grand or the Atlantic Falls, if the new legislation passes the Senate and is signed into law, it increases the authority. Instead of being able to monitor 3 days at the dam, feeding salmon, it would actually authorize removal of any sea lion that goes over 112 miles up the river and or in the tributary. So there would be the ability to remove more of those animals at those pinch points, which it would be part of the research would be what happens to the recruitment phase. There's one theory that a lot of scientists would agree with, that recruitment, if indeed we can be more effective in those areas, that recruitment would reduce. And you would get to the point where over time you would have to remove far less animals and perhaps even end the program.
So why can't we do that?
Yeah,
why don't we add a sentence then on A that says, and effectiveness of holding half on. What's the impact on the
shuttle?
What's the impact on the
sea?
Yeah,
that's
very much.
Your
next
in the
territory.
So channeling my inner Senator Rager. I do.
Everybody should.
There's a vaccine out there.
So this one seems to be passive, and we're looking for action items, things that we can do. So can we at the very least add some language that says concurrent with additional management or something that shows that any additional research that we do inviting the words with the guy that we've been doing research for the last 8 years, that we're not waiting for research to continue, but we're doing research as we're also concurrently seeking additional management structure.
Great thought, and we'll capture that in terms of how these things fit together, as opposed to this one being a specific element that does fit together.
But I think that brings up a really good point, Tom, in that A, as it is read now, is essentially you have an ongoing management program in the Columbia that would be informed by and help decision maker be able to determine what to do with that through A. Through B is a little different. It's in a place that we don't currently have authority to manage pin events. And it's one of the things that is needed in order to, if you are going to get approval for the NMPA, for that to occur. And also to answer questions like what Joe was asking about, you know, will this be effective? What is the current consumption rate? How does it compare with everything else? Things like that. So they're in a little different spot depending on if you're talking about A and B.
Terry, and I think that was
Terry.
Probably on the same page.
You guys are just so lined up.
Unlike Columbia River, we don't have the same problems as you sound. Our assessment we're trying to monitor is about the same. We've got about a decade of complaints to NOAA and rules and regulations to start sorting out how to affect that or to reduce the impact, which is basically how it works. The first thing is that the types of monitoring, first, the funding's not available to do a comprehensive monitoring, and then second, even when you do it, the structure isn't in place to make decisions on it. And so we just keep monitoring and monitoring, and meanwhile, you know, we're losing fish. Every time our fishermen go out, that's right in front of our tribe. You can see the boats going up and down the net trying to chase the seagulls off with, you know, things that make noise or splashing in the water, which is not very effective. But the complaints are there. NOAA has all the complaints from the river and from people and from all of the tribes. And we need a decision-making process. It's basically what we have is from Alaska to California protection of the plan on protection of seagulls and sea lions. So we seals have been allowed to just grow way beyond, you know, their carrying capacity. And we have to have some form of recognition of that because it is affecting coastline, the fishery populations, and especially when we're in this deep in the Davis Research Center. The Pacific Salmon Commission now has chosen the next act is still a Swinomish canal. As an endangered species to the point that they're now looking at about $56 million into trying to do something to boost that production. But you know, being able to manage the seals and sea lions more effectively would help reduce the types of money we're trying to put in chasing down the moss. So you know, we've got to have some kind of decision making that makes sense in this whole process about balancing our ecosystem.
So I'm generally hearing in this discussion, we're for this with some amendments and additions and clarifications. And connected to something else that moves it forward. So good. Right. You disagree with that?
Well, I mean, obviously we need science and monitoring related to any of our actions. But again, as we think about what are the key bold things that we're recommending this event to be, the laws of the of course, we can continue to refine the science, identify more specific locations, times, species, run timing. But I would like to see us take kind of all of our continued science and monitoring across all of our three threats and put that in something, because there's lots of specific actions to be done on each of these, and really it's just the continued funding for it to have a problem. So that, but I don't think it helps us to advance this as we're trying to get to 10 recommendations. I would not include science and monitoring in any of that. Instead, as a flip of that, I would say, and of course, the state and federal government need to continue to fund science and monitoring so that we can have this action over time. But it's, you know, it's, speaking as an elected official, the easiest way for me to do nothing is to say I need more study. I can do that every day of the week, every year, and I'll never get thrown out of office for that. Because that's a winner, right?
So do you say that if the working group comes back and says,
if we say we need more study to implement changes in a pet management, then we can give it everybody.
Well, how about to get authorization under the Marine Protection Mammal Protection Act?
The action becomes reduce predation by legal removal of pet pets through the authorizing process. But the action is reduce predation by removal of pet pets. The science is simply one of the steps we need to do together.
Okay.
Great. So the dissenting view to what you just said also came out in the working group, and the science is, depending on who you ask, essential if you want to get to management right away, but also essential for those folks that aren't yet convinced that this is a management action. And so that's why it's written more broadly instead of linked to a specific action. So they've written it to be a standalone.
All right, but it's our decision as a task force, is this or is this not an action in phase one? If we, a task force, don't believe we have adequate science to recommend this in phase one, then this is what we're done. If we, the task force, believe that we need to remove more benefits, then that's the statement we make, and then we task some of the people who are able to do this work to figure out how to do that. And if you need to do additional science to do it, you do it.
And I think that's an excellent, that's exactly one of the choices that Mark made at the beginning, is you can take any one of these and put them together. And so if science is just the first step and you just want to see it integrated into one of these other actions, then we can make that happen.
But I think what Will's saying is a little bit more important than that. And the statement up front, this is the action we want to take. There are the steps to get there, I think, is really important to approach it. And it helps focus the discussion and debate on that action.
I was just going to say that for Swinomish and front of the city never, we've had more seals at the mouth of the river than we had fishermen. And that ought to be evidence of something's wrong. And we need to be able to, again, like I said, set up a structure of decision making that we're sitting here trying to balance out our ecosystem. And you have to think it through. That should take that spot.
As a local analogy, linking those things together, we never adopted a plan that said do an EIS for Smith Island.
That's right.
The action was restore 400 acres we have to have. Of course, we have to do an EIS plan.
Right? So let's hear from Joe, and then we want to move on to look at the other ones, which are more about the action oriented thing.
Yeah, I guess I'm a little bit disappointed. One thing I want to point out, if you look up at that Science Columbia River Puget Sound, I think we have two completely different situations as far as pinnipeds are associated with. And I would really think that we need to uncouple those two things. So the Columbia River, no offense, the problem is the dam, right? That is what's going on there. And there's been a lot of work that's already going on down there with removal, and there's data that can be looked at for both pinnipeds and birds between them. In Puget Sound, the last published paper that we have on harbor seal density is from 2001. See, Jeffrey's has to date from 2016, but it's actually never been published. And then the increase of transient killer whales has been happening probably since about 2010. I'm just going to tell you, if you come out with a management plan that says harvest killer whales, you're going to get eaten alive in court because you have no scientific ground. You can't even tell me how many harvest seals are here. So you're going to get eaten alive. The governor's going to get eaten alive. You need to do your homework if you want to make these recommendations. And I don't debate any of the observations that you're making out there and that you're seeing when you're fighting animals off, but that doesn't stand up in the court of law right now. And so I think we need to decouple the Columbia River and the Puget Sound in the conversation.
This is another way to organize our recommendations around these two things, because specifically it's science-based and all the things.
And I think that in that case, Will, the point is that it's not going to come out, from my perspective, as a high recommendation to the governor. Instead, if that's something that's as real as everything else that we're hearing from today, from people that support the Bonneville Dam, but we still need more information on that if we can have the governor's support on that. And so I would like to couple them, and from that science, I don't, as a scientist, I love the importance of science and continued adaptive management and monitoring. But I'm just telling you, I don't think we have enough to move forward with the Puget Sound that's on right now. You know, you don't even have a starting point on that right now. So it's a showstopper for me as far as making a recommendation from a scientific perspective, somebody that studies marine mammals, to go forward that together.
So I would ask, and I'm going to move to the next one.
Yes, I would ask then, where did the science come from that NOAA recognizes and the fish program that the DFW recognizes 8.5 million schools here? So when there's science, the science behind that.
From the pit tags, is that?
In the Columbia.
Columbia, do I know first, 25 million, something
like that. Yeah, and not that, you know, you're right, Bush. We actually have three or four good publications that come out in the past few years about predation of smolts, not adults, but there. But the question then that you have to ask scientifically is, whenever you start taking the top predator out of the system, how many acres are you going to now eat that are going to start eating salmon smolts that are there? I mean, there's anytime you're dealing with a top level generalist predator, then harvest fields in the South Sea probably has somewhere between 50 and 65 different species of fish, then we don't have good information on what the ecosystem level implications are pulling those animals out of there. We don't have data on, if you pull animals out of the Swinomish estuary, are animals just going to move to a different area? Because, you know, the data we have shows that that population is at carrying capacity, and that what we don't have is the data that puts that population in the fish population.
So I'm hearing a thread that still that science and research, you know,
I'm just not convinced that the data is, that we have not to move forward.
Yeah, is in for a thread in here that that needs to be coupled with the other thing that moves it forward, whether it's first or second. That's one thing.
You don't have the incentive to answer that poll.
Well, I think we're already moving forward to Columbia River. I mean, that's, you know, and then their data is, the question is asking is, what's happening with those removals? What's the impact of those removals? And as you said, are those even being done in the correct manner or not? If you sound, I don't think we have enough data to start with.
So this is get the data, this is see what the data is telling us about.
I wish Michael was here, he had to leave, but it came up in a previous, a similar question in another group, and the difference between some of the things like you just said, like the level of smolts that have been eaten, right? Some of those studies are things that are either at the Salish Sea level or are using information that's a little bit older. So it's not something that B is actually something that's in progress right now. So Long Live the Kings, DFW, NOAA, Working with Tribes are trying to find newer population estimates that would be stock specific, which you would need if you wanted to go forward and do management actions. And they're getting invasion rates that are specific to Washington and not taken from British Columbia. So that's, I think, the clarification that he had on that one as far as the difference between what we already know and what they're saying we need to know to move forward. And I kind of hear Joe saying, yeah, we need something more. I think that's the something that he was inspired by.
So, right. A little confused. So we've got the tribes, and they're great biologists, and we got the state, and they're hardworking biologists. And we got NOAA, and they're hardworking biologists. So now I hear you say Long Live the Kings. And that's a group of a Walking Charter Association. Does that Walking Charter Association have science that can? I mean, what?
I just listed one entity, but this study's going on with all of the.
But control to me would come from the tribes, NOAA, and the state.
Yes, and all those entities are involved, but science isn't done that way with just one entity. It's done by putting together all of our heads and all of our data in order for that to happen.
And I think the point which is made is that Long Live the Kings is overseeing a U.S. joint Canadian study on what. Why do we have reduced survival of Chinook and Alpine?
So the higher authorities are paying for it. Just being
right, the Pacific Salmon Commission is funding that, and the science is being done by all the scientists that are involved.
So let's go.
One more comment. My main point was that with our monitoring systems, they're not designed, you just said, they're not designed to get us to an answer. And that's what we needed here. We need some mechanism along the line
and have a decision start. So tying it to the next thing.
Yeah. First, we don't have the funding. The second, even when you have the funding, you don't have the right decision-making process. And that's what we have to have to be that balance.
So we can add to that science thing, a decision structure step. There's then ties and links to the next steps, which we want to be talking about.
Which allows you to
segue
into what you want to get.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Okay, so next one, let's look at in your packet, Hydro-C, which is here, increased survival of predation hotspots associated with dams, and then lethal removal of birds to benefit specific runs and stocks. Again, what the working group said was that B2, lethal removal of birds, most of the things, and the work group is asking, the task force mentioned, and many others, are things that are included as actions that are happening or are recommended under options A to E under Hydro C. So we can talk about them a little bit together in the interest of time and connectivity here. So
I'll let Penny kind of run quickly through the A to E, because this comes from the working group. Again, this is A to E is ways to accomplish the survival simulation creation.
So, you know, as Mark said, we left the B2 box in there about birds, but when the working group brought forward their specific recommendations, they all thought that in some way they were connected to hydroseed. So unless you all have a suggestion of something outside of hydroseed that should be under lethal removal of birds, that one will likely just be wrapped into this hydroseed box. So A is about distribute the discharge and release of juvenile salmonids collected at Columbia State River dams, essentially not making them such easy prey. B is about support existing cormorant management plan objectives for ECM Island and Columbia River estuary. And so this is something that's already ongoing. It's already had an EIS. It's been approved through the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, et cetera. C is about request direct congressional appropriations and authority to the Army Corps to restore or create cormorant nesting habitat in non-sensitive areas. And so the partner to that one is D, which is support for the relocation of Caspian terns from the estuary to other places. The idea being, for example, with Caspian terns, historically we understand that they used to have more of an inland distribution. But as opportunities and breeding locations like dredge spoils and things like that showed up in the Columbia River, a lot of the Caspian tern population is now in places that overlap with ESA listed stocks and things like that. So there have been some efforts already to date to create more inland breeding habitat for species like Caspian tern, dissuade them and make the areas inhospitable for Caspian terns in places like the estuary, with the idea that they'll move farther inland where they are less of a problem.
And you know, the turns and the cormorants equal in terms of predation, how can cormorants create?
I don't know how to answer that. Do you know?
Yeah. Well, I think the turns were the primary problem in the estuary, but some of the relocation efforts have been effective, and I think the cormorants are now a bigger problem in terms of impacts on juveniles than the turns were, or the turns on this one. All together,
we're 20% or so. We're 20 years in for different management actions that have been tailored to Caspian terns, and cormorants are newer.
In the upper Great Lakes, the term for the cormorant population has been reduced dramatically in the last few years. And fish stocks have rebounded greatly.
Cormorants die deeper before they shut up in their Caspian terns.
So we got a hand up from Terry, and then some other chatter here. Yeah.
There is another piece of this that needs to be addressed, and that's with the federal, state, and local governments, our rules and regulations need to be harmonized. There's what we have now, and that we did a study on this. What we have is numerous agencies, like an impact assessment, to do their role following their rules on their impacts. The problem is that none of the rules are consistent. And when you want to do an impact analysis, you don't come out with a true picture of what's happening because of all the different self-serving rules. But you know, we've got a pilot project going on the Swinomish now in federal, state, and local governments. I'm not going to take those rules to start looking at having an impact. Having to be the approach the impacts that are getting throughout people's all the different levels.
So are you talking generally, or are you talking specifically about
it's with the birds and everything. The point is, all the federal, state, local government rules and regulations that are conflicting, I was one of the drafters of the first Southwater Quality Authority was developed yesterday. Well, we didn't know back in 1985 and 86 when we drafted that was that when we're relying on agencies to enforce or to regulate, they're not regulating the same things. In fact, most of them are conflicting. So when you do your assessments, you're not getting a true picture. So one of the recommendations that we're making through the GSEP partnership through this pilot project
great potential addition. Thoughts on these specifics and the general concept of predation management right roads?
Does this thing do more than what is being done right now? I guess I'm not, don't understand what's being done now and what new is being proposed. Are we just saying do more of? Or what? Because my understanding that all of these items are already happening in the Columbia River. And so I'm not sure what our recommendation is. Keep it up or?
What do you think it should be?
Well, I'm not sure I know enough to recommend that. And so, you know, maybe those of you that are working on the Columbia River and bottom boats can tell us what is new here. What are we adding value to, I guess?
Guy, you want to?
So, yeah, I have some awareness of what's going on with that. So, in terms of establishing habitat outside of the basin, that has been done with Caspian terms with some level of effectiveness.
Okay.
It has not been done for comments.
Okay.
And what the feasibility of that is, I don't know.
Okay.
But yeah, it's been for one of the species we're not together. There's another program for cormorants, hazing, plus actually lethal removal of cormorants that the Corps is implemented right now.
Brad?
Yeah, part of the lethal removal, I mean, one part, again, in the Upper Great Lakes, which has taken place over the last five or six years, was shooting. But also boiling the eggs and nesting stuff. Because if you break the eggs, they'll just re-nest or relay. But so shooting is a little more dramatic, but boiling is.
And Greg, to your point, I think correct me if I'm wrong, guy, but includes the management plan on East St. Island, includes the egg oiling, includes lethal management, and also I think changing of nesting area.
Relocating so, is, yeah, I would.
Say,
would
you think of
that? Oh, sorry. Yeah, hydro-CV.
Within the plan itself,
as much. Does,
yeah.
Doing some of these things. So, is there any way, before we push, Penny, for you to characterize the answer to Joe, is the sense of the working group that the point here is to enhance and accelerate, or to reinforce that we need to do existing things, or to find more resources to do the more and better, or is it specific to each one of the items?
I would have to go back on some of these and ask the working group specifically what some of them are, but the way that they're wording and knowing, I think, who put them in, I think some of them are more of a statement of support, and some of them are funding support and upfront, right? I think Guy said that they're already going to be asking in turn stuff, so that could be do more of it, right? The cormorant stuff would be brand new and probably would include a feasibility assessment and funding and everything else for them. So we would have to
So before we're doing it, I'd like to know that whoever the experts are doing it, that it's already 90% effective, or if it is 90% effective, we have 10% more to go. I mean, again, like with the contaminants and everything else, I want to know how much more chasing after. We find out with something else, okay, cormorants now are the issue, but there's 20% of the issue, or 5% of the issue, or 90% of the issue, and what that means, how long to implement, and what does that take? And you know, just like I said before, we shouldn't want to be putting forth optics or sound bites just to look good. We also can't be afraid though of the optics to sound bites that don't look good. So later on when we get to legal, our legal and then it's for some really bad optics.
I was gonna say, I think some of that information is available to the core reports.
Okay. It'd be great to have that information come back from the work. Let us know what's novel and what are we going to expect to get, and you know, what are we actually proposing?
Right.
It's like the letter to the governor to support it. We talked about it in the last one. You know,
what's
the included in there, but that's not going to be a substantive
right.
Recommendation.
And yeah. I think that's really good input for the working group. It's come up in a couple groups now. They want to know is it new and how much more lift we can get from it. So when we go back to the working group, we can specifically ask this question and use it as a way to filter out.
I think we're focusing on these areas where we really have to talk more because it's uncertain here on dogs.
Right.
So we're not talking about things like habitat, but just to remind us all, you know, these are the things where we weren't sure, so we're talking about it more. These are all kind of trying to manage the ecosystem, and historically we're not as successful at that, whereas some of the habitat actions are trying to restore the ecosystem process. So
and all that other stuff we're not talking about today.
That's why we're
needs to be
dealing with the clearly
original stuff.
Conditions of climate stress, just we move to the other predation ones, the artificial fallout removal, and then the lethal removal of extra comments. So option A1 is remove or alter artificial habitat fallouts in places that are most important for southern residents and Chinook, so they're not as attractive. B1 is lethal removal of pinheads to benefit specific runs and stocks. The commonality here, they're obviously very different. The commonality is that this working perspective is very focused on specific locations, specific places, using the knowledge that we have, getting additional knowledge as needed to then go after those places and those very specific populations to do removal, as opposed to some broader based micro approach.
And I think there's the artificial, then as far as natural, it's already there. Do we change anything by, I'm just asking a question, do we change anything by removing the artificial if the natural is already there for them to just go to?
And so those are excellent questions and leads to the great amount of uncertainty that the working group felt around this action, which is why A is about putting a pilot together to do this. So do this action, but monitor it well so we can learn from it. Where do they go? Is it effective? Do they go where we want them? They go where we don't want them to go. All of those questions so that we can learn from it. So it could be a pilot performed in all of the geographic areas or in one of the geographic areas, but if, due to that uncertainty, we don't know what will happen. That's what they ask.
Yeah, other groups definitely like that idea of a pilot to go here.
So we're still saying what? Move forward and then bring the mission back. Maybe it's in 2019 to say this is working, so continue. Am I trying to have to?
Well, except for the 2019 bit, because you'd still have to get authorization, and so it will take time to even get to a pilot and design it and all of that, and then adaptively manage it.
This one falls in my mind into the, we have a lot of other great things we know are going to be effective. I would just, this is not top 10. You know, if we have to reduce down 10, let's not choose the uncertain one.
And this one's almost.
Yeah, so, but I did think it's a good candidate for round two for the next year, and in order to have us avoid using pilot too many times, maybe it's prioritize the top 3 or 5 areas that we think we want to, where there's Chinook, blah, 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 blah. Let's go in, move those fallouts, and then figure out the results of that.
I'm seeing nodding at this.
Yeah, I
agree. Nice. We're just
Yeah, we're like,
yes. We're like, right out there,
just cooking. We're like, yeah. Yeah.
So this one is going to seem more aggressive than that because it involves legal removal. And if you want to characterize the elements that are underneath here and the connections of
the
FDA's.
So really briefly, A is to support the bills that are in Congress right now. This is the one that has already passed the House and is maybe going to be seen to the full Senate this year.
3119.
Yep. And B is, yes, support those bills and find funding for the removal program at a level sufficient to remove 95% or more of pinheads and pests. And the idea behind that, as I understand it, is that level of removal is seen as potentially necessary because of what we talked about before and that learned behavior of the animals. The idea that if you're able to remove the individuals that are most problematic, hopefully you will not have to continue to remove those individuals. And you can very quickly resolve the issue. Is that the right
question? Okay. Since this is Bonneville, Columbia River specific?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, specific to that bill,
it's here. Yep.
Which, depending if you're in the House and Senate, have different numbers, and we can put them in there if that was appropriate. But keep in mind, too, if it does not go into the Senate this year, it's likely to come around as another bill next session, and so we want to make it have a longer life for the task force if we chose to do that. And the third one is kind of connected to the research and science piece, but is a basic function that you would need in order to accomplish any of the legal removal under B1, is to have the most up-to-date stock information for each of harbor seals in Puget Sound. That isn't compiled yet for each of those stocks. And you need that in order to calculate the OSP, or optimum sustainable population, that then gives you a calculation to say, this is the number of individuals that you could take within each stock. And so that has to be, that assessment has to be done by NOAA and then reviewed by their science group in order for any of the management action under legal approval to happen. So requesting them to expedite that.
This puts the science in the right spot for you.
Yeah, so I'm fine with any or all of these. I am just a little protocol, a little perspective, a little uneasy when we've got a government task force that's going to make recommendations to the governor and our state legislature. And so when we recommend that we support federal legislation, I just get a little queasy about making sure that the governor's office is out and everybody's okay with that.
Yeah, that sounds like we're
getting into a lobby.
I had a comment about that.
I was going to say that there's letter of support of both the House bill and the Senate bill with the three governors.
So then why do we need to spend any time?
Governor Inslee signed both as well.
All right. So the only thing I can think of is you mentioned lobbying. The only thing I can think of, could have been this another task force that I'm on, we're providing information to the governor that ultimately goes to Congress to say, from our perspective, as we're working on the question of Orca recovery, we think this is an action that can support Orca recovery. And we're not lobbying them one way or another, we're just saying, we think this is an action that...
Another side we're talking about, if a broad-based group like this endorses moving forward with this, that helps the political viability of it, as opposed to anything like
that. I think that's exactly the perfect analysis.
I still have concerns that we're coupling Puget Sound and Columbia River together in this one.
So we're not, and that would mean that your guys' decision, right? So you can pick and choose from this list. If you only support A, or if you only support C, or B, or whatever, any and all of those things could happen. You don't have to say, I support all of them.
Yeah, and I'm good with C. I mean, I think that's the sort of information that we need to get that we were talking about when we were starting that. I would just plumb C over into that first one. We were talking about
into science.
For science, it's more convenient. Why couple it into some action item? Because it's not an action item, it's a science item that we need to take action.
I kind of agree, Joe, that I think the lump, I do think it's confusing to have Puget Sound stuff together with the Columbia. I do think they're.
Do you like the general front sound? I mean, Joe's.
Yeah, I
think this is a good way to kind of reorganize the same thing. So yeah. You can, it all supports the end.
You did, but once again, it's Milwaukee. So you can't recognize you got a problem in the Columbia River that's affecting killer whales and not recognize for later to be announced. Problems from the same problem you have by pinniped eating salmon that are which are acerbating the deaths of killer whales. You just can't do that. So if you support the Columbia River actions, then in the future you will support, I don't see if you will, but I will support the same actions that make sense in Puget Sound.
And in Columbia, it's the dams that are creating the artificial setting that has exacerbated the problem by concentrating, right?
I would just say this structure does not preclude that from happening. It just aligns the specific sort of steps underneath here, which are a little different given the science and given what's already taking place.
What I wanted to say is they can both do the same thing.
Both can be recommended if you decide.
If you come out with the monitoring dollars and the decision-making process on the monitoring dollars that actually gets you to a decision, yay or nay, but we don't do that. We throw a little money at it and say there's a problem and we keep throwing money at it, and that's not solving anything. You've got to have a decision-making structure that is followed that can come to a conclusion.
they disturb the depth. There's no salmon to eat, and then there's no killer whales, and so you are better solved. There's nothing to worry about.
As far as the timeline goes, I think that's something I don't know that we've talked about in this group, but that action under science that was the Puget Sound one, that's stuff that's already happening right now. We're not talking about, you know, waiting 5 years to start a new thing and all of that. These are things that are underway.
Even with that, though, what I just said earlier about the decision process, when you have so many agencies with conflicting rules and regulations, you don't get the outcome you need. And that's obvious when you understand the money we spent since 1986 when we adopted the estuary program to today. We're losing ground. And we're losing ground because the rules that we follow don't make sense. So we have to change the rules that have a process that's measurable. And we're not doing that. Once we have a measurable process, then things can come together. But as long as it's not measurable, all we come up with is band-aids that are getting the job done.
So,
can I go?
Yeah.
No, I'm good. Okay. So, we talked about bigger issues like even dam removal and all that, and we have to come, right, and come to a decision on some of these things or put it out there. Same thing. It's not fun. No one wants to choose one species over another species. We do have one in crisis, one or not. Despite being listed, we understand they're above carrying capacity. We'd like to, I think, some of us would like to know, what does that mean? You're above carrying capacity. How much are you above carrying capacity? 1%? 90%? I don't know. But then just like we talked about dams, Snake Rivers, and then all these other ones, we talked about Puget Sound and the Outer Coast, but can we even define that a little bit more? I mean, we know that there's choke points. We understand that, natural choke points. I mean, you won't like this, but Cattle Pass is an example of one. Maybe if you do have that pilot program,